Welcome to the Festival of the Summer Solstice Goddess, a celebration of women and all their accomplishments. Thank you so much to the Nicholas Endowment and to a very generous anonymous donor. The idea for a Summer Solstice Goddess Festival has been brewing for many years, actually. And we just thought that right now was the time for it. It's sort of the time of the woman. This festival focuses on the accomplishments of women, the art of women, and the spirituality of women. Remember the song, I Am Woman, by Helen Reddy? We're going to kick off our festival with that song because it has a lot of meaning to it. Listen to the words.
I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I'm not too much to go back and pretend. 'Cause I've heard it all before, and I've been down there on the floor. No one's ever gonna keep me down again. Oh yes, I am wise, but it's wisdom born of pain. Yes, I've paid the price, but look how much I've gained. If I have to, I can face anything. I am strong, I am invincible, I am woman. You can bend but never break me, 'cause it only serves to make me more determined to achieve my final goal. And I come back even stronger, not a novice any longer, 'cause you've deepened the conviction of my soul. Oh yes, I'm wise, but it's wisdom born of pain. Yes, I've paid the price, but look how much I've gained. If I have to, I can do anything. I am strong, I am invincible, I am woman. I am woman, watch me grow, see me standing toe to toe, as I spread my loving arms across the land. But I'm still an embryo, with a long, long way to go, until I make my brother understand. Oh yes, I am wise, but it's wisdom born of pain. Yes, I've paid the price, but look how much I've gained. If I have to, I can face anything. I am strong, I am invincible, I am woman, I am woman, I am invincible, ooh, I am woman, I am invincible, invisible.
Her mother was too, designing huge walls no man could ever get through. Born with a brick heart and mortar tongue, they made do. The only thing I know is to build those same walls too. Don't you build it too? tall, it may never fall. The air's getting thin. You're still human, fragile woman. My mother taught me the way to operate a crane. Ooh, a crane, carrying heavy loads with a smile through pouring rain. These walls are perfected, left me unprotected from that emptiness inside. No asking why, just get out while there's still time. Don't you build it too tall, it may never fall. The air's getting thin. You're still human, fragile woman. Ooh. Oh, don't you hurt yourself, no.
Lay down and die. I know not I will survive. I've got all my life to live. I've got all my life to give, and I will survive. I will survive. Oh, go on now, go. Walk out the door. Just turn around now, 'cause you're not welcome anymore. Weren't you the one who tried to bring me a goodbye? You think I'd crumble? You think I'd lay down and die? I know not I. I will survive. Oh, as long as I know how to love, I know I'll stay alive. I've got all my life to live. I've got all my love to give, and I will survive. I will survive. Hey,
hey. Thank you so much to the Nicholas Endowment for letting us bring this festival to you. This is the Festival of the Summer Solstice Goddess, celebrating women in their beauty, in their spirituality, in their accomplishments, and in the arts.
I went to Cornell University, where I met my husband on a blind date of all things. Marty and I married in 1954, when I was just 21. Marty finished the service when he got drafted, and we returned to New England in 1956, and I applied to Harvard Law School, where Marty was already enrolled. I was accused of taking a seat in law school away from a man who actually needed it to make a living. As you can imagine, I took my education very seriously, but this early experience, well, it lit my passion to fight for gender equality. I was only one of 9 women in the acceptance class of 500 people at Harvard Law School. And I remained at Harvard Law School until Marty got a job in New York, and then I transferred to Columbia in 1959. At the time of my graduation from Columbia Law in 1959, there were no anti-discrimination laws in place. In those days, I had 3 strikes against me. 1 was that I was Jewish. 2 was that I was a woman. And 3, the one that really did me in, was that I was a mother of a 4-year-old daughter. There was not a single law firm in the whole city of New York that would invite me to come, even for an interview. One of my professors at Columbia helped me get a position in a firm. I found my way into practicing, though, through a tax case of my husband's. I worked closely with the ACLU, the American Civil Liberties Union, in the 70s and 80s to take down common legal precedents of the time, such as Social Security laws that automatically designated women as homemakers and men as providers, and laws that did not allow women to become administrators of their families' estates. I argued 6 cases in front of the Supreme Court, and I won 5. I was first a trailblazing attorney for women's rights, and then the second woman appointed to the High Court. I fight for the equality of all people, to make life a little better for people less fortunate than you. That's what I think a meaningful life is. One lives not just for oneself, but for one's community. My mother told me to be a lady, and for her, that meant to be your own person, to be independent. I have always hated being told to be a lady. It's a statement drenched in sexism and expectations for how women must behave that I truly despise. But my mother, Celia Bader, her powerful definition is something I can live by, to be independent. My work with the ACLU helped bring down statutes across the country that defined men as head of household, laws that forced women to have their husbands co-sign their credit cards, and severely restricted women's working hours as protective measures. Women should have their independence in all manners, including financial. Women will have achieved true equality when men share with them the responsibility of bringing up the next generation. I said on the equality side of it that it is essential to a woman's equality that she be the decision maker, that her choice be controlling. My legal career came full circle in 2001 when I read the court's 7-1 opinion on United States versus Virginia, mandating that Virginia Military Academy open its doors to female applicants. State actors may not close entrance gates based on fixed notions concerning their roles and abilities of males and females, I said. Fight for the things that you care about, but do it in a way that will lead others to join you. What is dissent in the Supreme Court? It means that I disagree with one or more judges. You may wonder about these different colors that I wear. I like to call them dissent colors. This is one I wear when I agree with the court, but I have others when I disagree. Dissents, they speak to a future age. It's not simply to say my colleagues are wrong and I would do it this way, but the greatest dissents do become court opinions, and gradually over time, their views become the dominant view, so that the dissenters hope that they are not writing for today, but for tomorrow. My dissent in Ledbetter versus Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company was the inspiration for the Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act of 2009, a law that made it significantly harder for employers to pay women less than men. You might say dissenting made me an icon. Justice did not arrive like a lightning bolt, but rather through dogged persistence. I say real change, enduring change, happens one step at a time. My dissents were not cries of defeat. They were blueprints for the future. We are at last beginning to relegate to the history books the idea of the token woman. I do 20 push-ups a day, and I dedicate significant time and energy to supporting the arts on top of all my responsibilities. I love the opera, and when I got cancer 5 times, I continued working because my work was needed. It's so important. But my most fervent wish is that I not be replaced until a new president is installed. Well, I passed away the first night of Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year, in September 2020. And we know a new justice was appointed sooner than I wished. Listen, I dealt with bigotry, discrimination, and disrespect my entire life. But the fight doesn't end with me. We must all endeavor to speak against injustice. When I passed, I was still trailblazing. I was the first woman and the first Jewish person to lie in state. We must continue to blaze the trail for the future. Thank you.
Thank you. This is La Adelita, the most popular corrido, Mexican Revolution ballad. And it talks about a very young nurse, a 13-year-old, who joined the revolution because she believed, as many women did, on the cause of this important social movement, not only of Mexico, but of Latin America. So this is just a sample of how women participated in the Mexican Revolution in many categories, as nurses, as cooks, and also in the battlefield. La Adelita.
¡Y arriba las soldaderas!
En lo alto de una abrupta serranía, acampado se encontraba un regimiento y una joven que valiente lo seguía, locamente enamorada del sargento. Popular entre la tropa era Adelita, la mujer que el sargento idolatraba, que además de ser valiente era bonita, que hasta el mismo coronel la respetaba. Y se oía que decía aquel que tanto la quería. Y si Adelita se fuera con otro, la seguiría por tierra y por mar. Si por mar en un buque de guerra, si por tierra en un tren militar. Y si Adelita quisiera ser mi esposa, si Adelita ya fuera mi mujer, le compraría un vestido de seda para llevarla a bailar al cuartel. Yo soy rielera, tengo mi Juan, él es mi vida, yo soy su querer. Cuando me dicen que ya se va el tren, adiós mi rielera, ya se va tu Juan. Tengo mi par de pistolas con sus cachas de marfil para darme de balazos con los del ferrocarril. Yo soy rielera, tengo mi Juan, él es mi vida, yo soy su querer. Cuando me dicen que ya se va el tren, adiós mi rielera, ya se va tu Juan. Cuando me dicen que ya se va el tren, adiós mi rielera, ya se va tu Juan.
Are you enjoying our festival? If you are, then in the comments box, please put value if you value what you have seen. Learn if you're learning something new, and fun if you're having fun.
Shalom, my name is Rabbi Robin Funberg. I knew I wanted to be a rabbi 20 years before I became one. I felt called to lead, to nurture, and to teach. I felt called by people around me who believed in me and who mentored me. I stand on the shoulders of many women who fought to be accepted into rabbinic seminaries. And because they fought, more than 50% of rabbinic students today are women. And I'm proud to say that my daughter is one of them. Women rabbis have made a difference in Jewish life. They have rewritten Jewish rituals. They have thought deeply about Jewish women's voices throughout history and provided thought-provoking scholarship. Women rabbis lead not just synagogues, but national organizations and Jewish movements. Having women in leadership means that our girls are treated like the boys in our religious schools. They have the same rituals and the same rites of passage. Women are now synagogue presidents as well as spiritual leaders. I love being a rabbi. I love teaching from the pulpit and in the classroom. Being a rabbi is being a leader in the community. It is doing the holy work of standing up for what's right and guiding with an informed moral compass. A rabbi is a spiritual guide, helping seekers develop their relationship with the divine and helping those wrestling with the divine to provide comfort, healing, and understanding. Being a female rabbi is to experience the same challenges as a female CEO. There will always be those who will cast doubt. But being a rabbi has taught me to rise above, to keep the faith, and to be true to myself. I pray to Shekhinah, the feminine aspect of the divine presence, for strength, for wisdom, and for dignity, for myself and for all women. May Shekhinah hold us, all women rabbis, as we take our place as leaders, guides, and teachers. And may Shekhinah bless our girls, our future rabbis and leaders, with courage and faith. Amen.
Is this the little girl I carried? Is this the little boy at play? I don't remember growing older. When did they? When did she get to be a beauty? When did he grow to be so tall? Wasn't it yesterday when they were small? Sunrise, sunset, swiftly grow the days. Seedlings turn overnight to sunflowers, blossoming even as we gaze. Sunrise, sunset, swiftly grow the years. One season following another, laden with happiness and tears. Now is the little boy a bridegroom? Now is the little girl a bride? Under the canopy I see them side by side. Place the gold ring around her finger. Taste the sweet wine and break the glass. Soon the full circle will have come to pass. Sunrise, sunset, swiftly go the days. Seedlings turn overnight to sunflowers, blossoming even as we gaze. Sunrise, sunset, swiftly go the years. One season following another, laden with happiness and tears.
The songs we're presenting today were written by women composers in the 16th century up through the 19th century. Many of these women were musicians in their local communities. Many of them were nuns living in convents and contributing to their communities through the music they wrote, the music that they performed, and the music that they taught. So these women became integral part of the fabric of music growing in these communities, learning about music in these communities. Most of the songs that we will hear today were written by Italian female composers, most of them living in convents and contributing to their musical societies. However, Se Spiegar was actually written by a Polish composer, Maria Szymanowska, who wrote in the Italian style, but spent most of her life in Poland and in Russia. I'm thrilled to present for you some of our wonderful students from the Classical Voice Conservatory. These are students making up our graduating seniors down to our rising sophomores and juniors who are aspiring to sing classically and to present their art in the most polished and refined way that they can. Each song is masterfully written and has lots of traditional elements as well as some little surprises as you listen to the text and how the music juxtaposes against it or goes along with it. And it's wonderful that these songs have been brought back to publication so that we can perform them as we will for you today. Enjoy.
Volgere sti a me lo spirito. su e fa due merito che amor non sa più. Amore bandito, amanti su e fa due merito che amor non sa più. E fa due merito che amor non sa più. Chi mera il cervello al cuo gelosie, passioni. Passioni, passioni pazzie, sentite al budello, il caso è spedito, 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 spedito.
Amore bendito, amanti sassù, e fatto ne dito che amor non sia più. Amore bendito, amanti sassù, e fatto ne dito che amor non sia più.
Amore bandito, amanti su, è fatto inedito che amor non sia più, è fatto inedito che amor non sia più. Pronunzi con forte rallegre il cuore, chil bando di amore, bandit alla morte, il corpo è riuscito. Ruscito, ruscito, ruscito. Amore bandito, amanti su. E fatto è inedito che amor non sa più. Amore bandito, amanti su. E fatto è inedito che amor non sa più. E fatto è inedito che amor non sa più.
Today we are starting, with chakra. Chakra is the ancient, you know, meditation focal point, and it has been practiced for a long time. The function of the chakra is to spin and draw inside of the person the energy to keep our spiritual, mental, you know, emotional and physical body in balance. So chakra is needs, you know, to be activated in our body, and basically it needs crystal stones to heal and support and protect our body and mind. So chakra, there are seven chakras. The chakras start from the head down to the bottom, and you know, hands and legs too. So we're gonna start with the seventh chakra. The seventh chakra is also called the crown. It is on top of the head, and the function of this chakra is to penetrate downward into the body, and it controls the physical and mental movement and development. And again, it controls basically the whole body from top to bottom. So we need to open this chakra, and the best crystal for this chakra is the violet color, which is in amethyst and in sugilite and in violet fluorite. So these are over here are the, you know, the best color of chakra, because this amethyst is very dark and violet color of the chakra for number seven. So and then we go to chakra number six, which is the sixth chakra. The sixth chakra is also called the third eye, and it is located in our, you know, forehead, right there in the middle. What it does, it coordinates the movement of face and eyes and nose, and it also coordinates the sounds, the smell, and the sight. To open this chakra, to activate this chakra and open it to our, you know, use, we need sodalite, and very dark blue sodalite or indigo dark blue. And these are over here, you know, the best crystal of sodalite. You know, we can have it as a pendant to wear it, or we carry the stone as, you know, as a stone in our pocket. The fifth chakra is, we call it, you know, it's a blue light color, and it is in the lower part of our throat. So we call it a communication chakra because it is connected to our spine and nervous system. Through this chakra, we can express our feeling, we can express our thoughts, and we can also enjoy, you know, our speech. And you know, we can expand with this chakra a lot, because it is the beautiful piece to be creative. And the color is light blue, and the light blue always is you know, indication of creativity. So we can use light sapphire, that's a blue light color, and we can use aquamarine, and you can use a turquoise for this chakra. So now we are going down, you know, to the heart, which is the fourth chakra, and it is green. It's always green. What heart does, you know, it achieves virtue, it achieves love, security, stability, and faithfulness. To open this chakra, we need a green method. So the best thing for this chakra is gonna be the green emerald, or green jade, or green tourmaline. These are the best colors, you know, for the heart. Stays always green. If we move down a little bit, and it's gonna be the third chakra, and the third chakra is gonna be above the belly button. What this chakra does, it is responsible of developing our personality. It protects us from false friends and from false promises. So to activate this chakra, it is very important, and it draws this chakra sign is basically is going to be the sun. So the color of this chakra is going to be a very golden yellow color, and it's really associated with power and intellect, the yellow color. So what we need for this chakra is we get either yellow topaz, which is right there, or citrine. They both are beautiful color, which is driven from the power of golden color. If we move a little bit down, is going to be the second chakra. The second chakra is orange, and it is called spleen. And the spleen is going to be below the belly button. And what it does, this chakra, and when this colors, it is encouraging the erotic feeling and the feeling of success, the feeling of joy, the feeling of appreciation of good meal. So to open this chakra, we need a very powerful and best crystal, and the best crystal is in amber and yellow topaz. The last one is gonna be the chakra number one. It is in the bottom right here. It is in the bottom, and that is called the root chakra, or also we can call it the base chakra. And this is very important. It is responsibility is a self-assertion. And it is, again, we come to trust, stability, and sexuality. And what this chakra does is controlled by red color. The red is very important for this chakra. So the best thing to use for this chakra is ruby, garnet, and red carnelian is right here. And when we come to our hands and feet, so what we can do is to activate our hands and feet, always we can use a combination of all these chakras. And that is basically for the whole body, and that is what we basically use for the meditation and clearing our thoughts and energy and our mind. Thank you.
Have you enjoyed the festival? Now, this is our food adventure for this festival. It's Mexican fruit salad. And needless to say, it is extremely healthy. A lot of vitamins, a lot of antioxidants, a lot of really good stuff. There are oranges and cantaloupe, strawberries, pecans, walnuts, coconut, raisins, all kinds of really good stuff in here. Papaya. Want to make this salad? Go to bowers.org and download all the recipe, all the ingredients, and it'll be a really nice summer treat. Now, after you enjoy your salad, do an art project. Our super art instructor, Lupe, is going to show you how to do love beads from the 1960s.
Hello everyone. I hope you enjoyed the Goddess of the Summer Solstice Festival this month. For the art project, we are going to be making love beads. So love beads are worn as a symbol of love and peace. So they were worn in the 60s and 70s by the hippies. So the men and women would wear long necklaces made usually with handmade beads. So the beads were influenced by Native American and Indian cultures. So for this art project, you are going to need pieces of paper. Usually one is enough. You're going to need some string, some markers, a glue, scissors, and I'm using a lollipop stick to help roll the beads, a ruler, and then some extra beads. So once you have your supplies, let's get started. So we are going to be making tube beads. So they are just tubes made out of paper. So the size of them depends on you. So here's some examples of large ones. Okay, how you decorate them is also up to you. So here we have more intricate designs. This one added glitter. This one some foil. Okay, so this one has some gems on it. So really it is up to you how you want to decorate them. You can also just cut out pieces from like a magazine. So these are just cut pieces. So this one, okay, so that's up to you as well. If you find sheets of paper that are colorful already, for example, some scrapbooking paper, okay, so you can use that as well. Okay. So the first step is to cut out the paper. So again, the size depends on you. Mine are going to be about an inch wide. So I'm going to use a ruler and I'm going to start at the edge and I'm just going to mark all the 1 inch. If you have a paper cutter, you can use that. So I'm going to make marks all the way through the sheet so then I can cut it out. Now these are going to give you long strips of paper. You can also do it this way. Okay, so that just means that the beads will be less thick. So again, if you have a cutter, feel free to use that so you have straight pieces of paper. So for each necklace, you need about 12 beads. And that's not including some extra beads. Now the best thing about the 2 beads is that you don't have to decorate the entire strip. All you have to decorate is the very end. So about an inch, inch and a half, and that's all you need. So you're gonna need markers, coloring pencils, crayons, so anything, pens, just to decorate the very end. So let me just do something simple. So we want colors of the summer. So if you have the time, you can be as intricate as you want, as colorful as you want. You can do like this one where it's just each bead is one color. Or like this one, I really like this one. So it's like a little pattern, wavy pattern. That looks really nice. I'm trying to do something simple so that I can be faster. Okay, I really should have stopped right there. Okay, so then you're gonna decorate all your pieces. So if you want them all on the same necklace, you can have the same pattern, different patterns. Okay. So once you're done decorating, you are going to flip over the strip and you're gonna start at the opposite end. And then you're just gonna roll it up. Okay, so I have a lollipop stick. So this one gives a nice shape to it and it's nice and small. You can use a straw, but usually that gives you a very large hole for the beads. You can try something smaller, but sometimes the string won't fit. So it also depends on what kind of string you're using. So I have these stretchable ones, so it's nice and thin. So this will fit pretty much any bead that I have. So if you're using yarn, just make sure that whatever you're using, that it makes a big enough hole for your string. Okay, so you're gonna need your glue and your lollipop stick. You're gonna start at the end and you're just gonna roll it up. This is where it shows you if you cut evenly or not. Okay, so you start at the end and you roll up. And right away it goes crooked. Now the good thing about this one is you can take it out and fix it and then put the stick back in and then keep rolling. Okay, so you can use the table, you can use your fingers. And I'm gonna take it out, fix the edges, keep rolling. And then this is where it shows that you only need to decorate the very end. Okay. So once you get to the very end, you see it's being covered up by that. So no need to decorate the entire bead. Okay, so once you get to the very end, you're gonna add glue pretty much where you decorated. Make sure you glue the edges. Okay, and then you roll it up. Press down on it for a few seconds to make sure that the glue is working. Well, that gives a very nice pattern right there. And there's one bead. Okay. So let me do another one really fast. So I like the wavy one, so I'm gonna do something similar. I'm gonna do little triangles. So you saw with the first bead how the edges are white, right? We didn't decorate all of it, so it gives us that white color. So you can also dip these in paint. You can also just try coloring it in afterward. Or what you can do is you can take your marker and you sort of go all the way along just the edge. Oops. So be careful at the end that you don't mess up your artwork like I just did. Okay, so that's just the very edge. So then same thing, you flip it over and you're gonna start at the opposite end. You have your stick. And you're gonna roll it up. And right away you can see that color. So it's no longer white, so the edges are now outlined in that dark purple color that I used. So it gives it a nice outline. And here we go at the very end, covered up by our design. Okay. So just add glue to the very end. Press down, make sure that the glue is holding. Okay, so here we go, the difference between outlining and not outlining. Okay, so once you have all your beads, then you're just going to add them to your necklace. You can also add more designs to your beads. So if you have, again, like glitter, go crazy with glitter, okay? If you have foil, some gems, stickers, you can make your beads out of stickers. You can write little words on them as well. So if you have like gel pens or anything like that, you can write words really small on here, if you can. Okay, so adding them to the yarn, to your string, is pretty easy. Oops. If you have some other beads, you can just add them to it. So make it a pattern, just make sure you string them, make sure it doesn't fall out on the other side. Okay, make it into a pattern and have fun designing your necklace. Now, you've seen that these are just made out of paper, so if you get them wet, they'll be destroyed. So if you have Mod Podge or nail polish, you can cover them up with that to protect them, to make them waterproof. So just use wax paper to cover your area. Just cover them with Mod Podge or nail polish and leave them on the wax paper to dry. And then once they're fully dry, then you can bead your necklace. So here are the samples, better made than mine, to give you some ideas. This one was music inspired. Took quite a long time. So if you have some fun beads, that can also be make your necklace look very interesting. Okay, you can color coordinate. Okay, so once you string them on, just tie the string into a knot and then you can wear it. So I hope you like this art project, and I would love to see you wearing your necklaces made out of handmade beads. So we'll see you at the next festival. Bye.